Resilience. How to cope when everything around you keeps changing. By Liggy Webb. Read by Jilly Bond. This book is dedicated to friendship. Thank you to the charming gardeners who make our souls blossom. It is not the critic who counts. Not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again, because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat. For those who have had to fight for it, life has truly a flavour the protected shall never know. From a speech given by Theodore Roosevelt on the 23rd of April 1910 at the Sorbonne in Paris. An Introduction to Resilience. Our greatest glory is not in never falling, but in rising every time we fall. Confucius. Have you ever felt sometimes as if you would like to stop the world and get off for a while? Just to have a little rest, recover and make sense of it all? In the increasingly demanding and changing world that we live in, it is so easy sometimes to become overwhelmed and feel as if you were sinking. At some point, everyone experiences varying degrees of setbacks. Some of these challenges might be relatively minor, and others may have a major impact. How you deal with these problems can play a major part in the ultimate outcome and also your long-term psychological well-being. Resilient people are able to utilise their skills and strengths to cope and recover from the knockbacks and challenges, which could well include illness, job loss, financial problems, natural disasters, relationship breakups, or the death of someone you love. If you lack resilience, you may become overwhelmed by these experiences and simply fall apart. You may find yourself dwelling on your problems and using unhealthy coping mechanisms to deal with the pain and heartache. It would be fair to say that some individuals do indeed have personality traits that help them remain calm in the face of adversity. Others may well react more emotionally and dramatically. We will, of course, all react differently to trauma and stress in our lives. Some people take a more stoic approach and keep their feelings hidden. Others may become more expressive and emotional. Different personalities tend to process information in a variety of ways, and your reaction will be part of your coping mechanism. The key, however, is the end result. It isn't necessarily a question of how far you fall, but how high you can bounce back. Sometimes maybe even bigger, better and stronger as a result of the experience. Like the boomerang on the cover of the book, you show true resilience by returning from each experience relatively unscathed and ready to face positively the next challenge that life may throw your way. What you need to avoid is becoming a doomerang, returning from each experience loaded with negative baggage, resentments and pain that could well haunt you for the rest of your life and make the next situation even harder to deal with. Resilient people do not allow adversity to drain their resolve. They find a way to pick themselves up, dust themselves off and keep going with a strong belief that things can and will get better. Resilience comes from the Latin word resilio, which means to jump back. Some people describe resilience as the ability to bend instead of breaking under pressure, or the ability to persevere and adapt when faced with challenges. The same abilities also help us to be more open and willing to take on new opportunities. In this way, resilience is more than just survival. It is also about letting go and learning to grow. Throughout this book, you will find that some of the greatest examples of people who cope exceptionally well with adversity are those who adopt a positive mental attitude. As a total advocate of positivity, I would like to share with you a very recent story about resilience, which involves my own family. A personal story of resilience. To set the scene, my parents have been together for over 60 years, married for nearly 58, and have three children. Certainly, they've had their share of challenges and heartache. However, they are both strong, positive people who cope amazingly well with whatever life throws at them. 3 years ago, my father started feeling breathless and tired. As a very fit 75-year-old who sailed every weekend and went to gym 5 times a week, it was thought that perhaps he was overdoing it. He was sent to see his doctor, who said that he had a heart murmur, and sent him to see a consultant at the local hospital. This was diagnosed as a moderate condition. Last year, however, it was discovered that he had severe thickening of the aortic valve, and after an angiogram, he was told that he needed a quadruple bypass, as well as a valve replacement. The situation was diagnosed as severe, and he was put on a waiting list, with his health deteriorating on a daily basis. He was given strict instructions to do no more sailing, no more gym, and to remain wrapped in cotton wool until after the operation. For someone who was used to an active life, this was very challenging. Each day he waited, with no communication of when the operation would be. Bouts of anxiety and depression became frequent as his life was put on hold. To watch my parents go through this ordeal alone was heart-wrenching, as they were rendered helpless. 1 year later, he was finally given an operation date. The news, when it finally came, was seemingly akin to winning the lottery. The whole family was tremendously relieved. The evening before the operation, my mother and I took my father into hospital, and I watched them say their goodbyes. Knowing the severity and the risk of the operation, I have to say I struggled to hold it together. After 60 years of being together, they knew there was a chance, as with any major operation, that this could be the last time they saw each other. Knowing it was a 6-hour operation, I tried to keep my mother busy as we both waited with our hearts in our mouths. All we wanted to do was call to be able to hear that everything had gone well. 4 hours later, the phone rang and I answered it, my mouth dry with anticipation and fear. It was a surreal experience to hear my father's voice on the end of the line.
"Well, it's like this,"
his ghost-like voice whispered down the phone line.
"I was all ready to go into the theatre. They'd prepared me, put my gown on. I'd even had a Mexican."
I didn't feel it was appropriate to correct him at that point.
"And then they said that I was going to be discharged because they didn't have any critical care beds left."
My mother and I immediately went to see my father, and we found him sitting on the end of his hospital bed, looking somewhat bewildered, trying to make sense of this surreal situation. Despite their extraordinary efforts to remain calm, I could see the fear in my parents' eyes as they imagined being flung back into the bureaucracy of waiting lists, and it seemed almost too unbearable to imagine. No one was able to give us any information, only that my father should return home and wait for the next available slot, which could be days, weeks, or months. We returned home, and I watched my parents muster a huge amount of resilience as they both discussed how they would deal with the situation. They realised that the situation was out of their control, and they made a pact to be calm and patient, and that things would be resolved if they remained positive. After being at home for about 2 hours, the telephone rang. Half expecting it to be a concerned relative, I answered it. I was told that my father should return immediately to the hospital, as a critical care bed had become available, and my father would be operated on the next day. Repacking his bag, we traipsed back to the hospital. This, I'm sure you can imagine, would be an ordeal for anyone, let alone two people near to 80. We left my father that evening and called later to see if he was settled. He said he had spoken to the sister on the ward, who said he was doing very well, and she was surprised at how positively he had dealt with it all. Apparently, he had said to the sister that his daughter wrote books about being positive, and he had then proceeded to tell her that he had PMT. "Oh, sir," the sister had said, "I think you mean PMA. "No," he had apparently told her quite adamantly, "I think under the circumstances I am entitled to have PMT. The next period of time was an even more nerve-wracking ordeal, because after the operation, my father remained in a coma, unable to come off the life support machine. Eventually, after a week, he came out of critical care, and with all the drugs and tubes that had been attached to him, he was convinced that he was on the moon. My father is now recovering very well, and with the support of my mother and various health professionals, he is back on his feet and enjoying his latest passion of model yacht racing. He says he feels he has a new lease of life, and most certainly seems to have bounced back even better than before, despite having been through a somewhat traumatic ordeal. As you will see, I take courage from other people's stories as well as my own experiences, and dotted throughout this book are some other enlightening and inspiring examples. I have changed a few names where appropriate to protect privacy. Some people, it seems, have more than their fair share of pain. Certainly, some of the stories in this book will demonstrate this. However, those stories have reaffirmed my belief that it is not what happens to you in life, it is how you respond and deal with the situation that matters. In my previous book, How to Be Happy, my aim was to help people to feel better about themselves and their lives. This book, however, goes a little more deeply into helping people to handle the trials, tribulations, and curve balls that life throws at us from time to time. I have outlined 10 key strategies for developing resilience, with information, tips, and techniques so that you can develop your own coping mechanism and take better control of your life. 1. Take a journey of self-discovery. Self-awareness and self-confidence play an essential role in helping you to cope with stress and recover from difficult events. Understanding yourself is the first port of call, and after that, reminding yourself of your strengths and accomplishments is key. Becoming more confident about your ability to respond and deal with crises is a great way to build resilience for the future. Challenges can be stepping stones or stumbling blocks. It's just a matter of how you view them and how much faith you have in yourself to overcome them. 2. See the glass half full. Staying positive during dark periods can be difficult, and it is important to maintain a hopeful outlook. Being an optimist does not mean being naive and ignoring the problem. It means understanding that setbacks are transient and that you have the skills and abilities to combat the challenges you face. There is a huge risk when something difficult arises that you fall into the pessimistic trap of believing that everything is doom and gloom. So much of resilience is about how you choose to react to each situation, and an optimistic perspective will most certainly lead you in a more positive direction. 3. Take emotional control. Being emotionally aware and recognising how potentially you can react in certain situations will help you to exert more self-control. It will also help you to be more considerate with regards to how your reactions can affect other people. High emotion can be quite exhausting, so managing emotions during any ordeal will help you to focus your energy where it's best placed. People who have better emotional awareness and understand their own emotions have been shown to be far more resilient. 4. Change for the better. Being positive about change is a really good approach, you may not be able to control or change circumstances. However, you can absolutely change your attitude towards them, so you are far more in control than you think. Flexibility is an essential part of being able to manage change, and by learning how to be more adaptable, you will be much better equipped to respond to any life crisis you experience. Resilient people often utilise these events as an opportunity to branch out in new directions. While some people may be crushed by abrupt changes, highly resilient individuals are able to adapt and thrive. 5. Cope well with conflict. Conflict is an inevitable part of life. We all have different personalities, and along with those go belief systems, values, perspectives, likes and dislikes. Some conflict can be difficult, and at times unsettling, especially if you take it personally and are very sensitive. The outcome of conflict, however, can be very positive. It can help you to create new ideas, learn from others, understand yourself better, see different perspectives, and improve your own communication. Learning how to cope with and manage conflict is a very important life skill in the increasingly diverse world that we live in. 6. Embrace probopportunities. The word probopportunity is a hybrid between the word problem and opportunity, and looks at the concept of taking every problem situation and seeking out the opportunity. It works on the premise that in every crisis situation, an opportunity will arise and there will be some benefit. It is a useful approach to problems and helps you to come at them from a positive angle. Developing a good set of problem-solving skills is a valuable toolkit to equip yourself with, and knowing what practical steps to take will give you confidence when you are faced with adversity. 7. Look after yourself. When you are feeling traumatised, stressed and upset, it can be all too easy to neglect your own well-being. Losing your appetite, overeating, not exercising, not getting enough sleep, drinking too much alcohol, not drinking enough water, driving yourself too hard are all common reactions to a crisis situation. This is the time when you need to work on building your self-nurturance skills, especially when you are troubled. Making time to invest into your well-being will boost your overall health and resilience, and you will be better equipped to face life's challenges. 8. Make connections. Building and sustaining a strong network of supportive friends, family and work colleagues will act as a protective factor during times of crisis. It is important to have people you trust and can confide in. Whilst simply talking about a situation with a friend or loved one will not necessarily make troubles go away, it will allow you to share your feelings, gain support, receive feedback, and come up with possible solutions to your problems. Listening to other people's experiences can be really useful too, and although we can't always learn from others' mistakes, there will certainly be some good advice out there. 9. Keep going. Winston Churchill summed this up perfectly.
If you are going through hell, keep going.
There is a lot to be said for picking yourself up, dusting yourself off, and carrying on. Being resilient is about the ability to bounce back and get on with life. The key is to think of each setback or upset as a stepping stone, and it is really important to be able to do this as quickly as possible. Letting go of the angst that you experience too is very important, rather than carrying lots of negative baggage with you that will just weigh you down and make the journey ahead more difficult. 10. Create a vision. In times of crisis, or when you are feeling low, it is good to hold on to your dream and not lose sight of the fact that you can always have something to look forward to. There are lots of benefits to creating a vision and setting goals. First and foremost, they help you to develop clarity, which is the first step to helping you achieve what you want in life. Goals unlock your positive mind and release energies and ideas for success and achievement. Without goals, you simply drift and flow on the currents of life. With goals, you fly like an arrow, straight and true to your target. Setting goals gives you direction, purpose, focus, and most important of all, hope. At the end of each chapter, there are also some reflection exercises where you can examine your own needs and set out a personal action plan to ensure that you truly benefit from this book. Knowledge is much more valuable when you put it to good use. This book is written with the intention of providing you with some fundamental strategies that will help you to navigate some of the challenges you may face in your life. It has been designed to be an easy and accessible read, so you won't find a huge amount of science and theory. It cuts through unnecessary complexity and will provide you with simple solutions to get back on track and trust that tomorrow has every possibility of being a brighter, better day. Liggy Webb. Learn from yesterday, live for today, hope for tomorrow. Albert Einstein. How resilient are you? Before you start to listen to this book, it will be interesting for you to see just how resilient you are. This quiz will take you a few minutes to complete and will give you some indication of how you're doing. Get ready to rate yourself from 1 to 5 on the following. 1 equals very little, 5 equals very strong. In a crisis or chaotic situation, I calm myself and focus on taking useful actions. I'm usually optimistic. I see difficulties as temporary and expect to overcome them. I can tolerate high levels of ambiguity and uncertainty about situations. I adapt quickly to new developments. I'm good at bouncing back from difficulties. I'm playful. I find the humour in rough situations and can laugh at myself. I'm able to recover emotionally from losses and setbacks. I have friends I can talk with. I can express my feelings to others and ask for help. Feelings of anger, loss, and discouragement don't last long. I feel self-confident, appreciate myself, and have a healthy concept of who I am. I'm curious. I ask questions. I want to know how things work. I like to try new ways of doing things. I learn valuable lessons from my experiences and from the experiences of others. I'm good at solving problems. I can use analytical logic, be creative, or use practical common sense. I'm good at making things work well. I'm often asked to lead groups and projects. I'm very flexible. I feel comfortable with my paradoxical complexity. I'm optimistic and pessimistic, trusting and cautious, unselfish and selfish, and so forth. I'm always myself, but I've noticed that I'm different in different situations. I prefer to work without a written job description. I'm more effective when I'm free to do what I think is best in each situation. I read people well and trust my intuition. I'm a good listener. I have good empathy skills. I'm non-judgmental about others and adapt to people's different personality styles. I'm very durable. I hold up well during tough times. I have an independent spirit underneath my cooperative way of working with others. I've been made stronger and better by difficult experiences. I've converted misfortune into good luck and found benefits in bad experiences. Add your total. Scoring. Over 85, you demonstrate high levels of resilience. 65 to 85, you show the ability to be resilient in most situations. 50 to 65, you can cope in some situations. 40 to 50, you really struggle to be resilient. Under 40, you really need to work on developing resilience. Resiliency quiz with permission by Practical Psychology Press from the Resiliency Centre website, based upon The Resiliency Advantage by Al Siebert, PhD, 2006, Berit Kohler. Chapter 1. Take a journey of self-discovery. Promise me you'll always remember. You're braver than you believe, and stronger than you seem, and smarter than you think. Christopher Robin to Pooh by A.A. Milne. Whenever something happens in your life that may result in loss or change and pain, in whatever guise, something very special can occur at the same time. You are given an opportunity to reassess your position in life and to learn something new and potentially empowering. Resilience very often is referred to as the ability to bounce back from adversity. The question to ask is, do I want to bounce back to where I am right now? It may be that through the apparent process of upset and upheaval, you can move your life into a far better position than it is at the moment. The situation that may be causing your current anxiety may well be a springboard for you to make some positive changes that you would never have thought of before. Reassessing the relationship you have with yourself is very important, because this will be the time that you need to tap into all your inner strength and work on any weakness. There will, of course, be people around you who can support you. However, you are ultimately your own salvation, and developing your coping ability is essential to survival. Feeling positive about who and what you are will provide you with a solid foundation, and developing a healthy amount of self-respect and self-worth is a good place to start. Be your personal best. It is important, first of all, to take personal responsibility for being the best that you can be. So often, it is easy to compare yourself to others, and if you do this, you run the danger of engendering two emotions, one of vanity or one of bitterness, because there will always be people you come across who you perceive as better or worse off than yourself. It is also pointless to benchmark yourself against others. Using yourself as your own benchmark is far more constructive. My sister, Jackie Pearson, is a wonderfully talented watercolour artist who lives in New Zealand. When I first started writing, I lacked confidence in my ability to be as good as other writers, and she said that she had felt the same about her art. She decided one day, however, that she would no longer allow herself to do this, and her focus and ambition would be about being a better artist than she had been the year before, and use this as her goal and herself as her own benchmark. This was a great piece of advice, and certainly helps take away the weight of pressure that we can so unnecessarily put upon ourselves. Just be you.
Persons of high self-esteem are not driven to make themselves superior to others. They do not seek to prove their value by measuring themselves against a comparative standard. Their joy is being who they are, not in being better than someone else.
Nathaniel Brandon. Imagine having no one to compare yourself with except yourself. What a sense of relief this would bring. You wouldn't have to give yourself a hard time about not performing as well as your colleagues at work.
You wouldn't have to worry about not looking like the most attractive person with the smartest mind, or having the most important job role and the biggest pay packet. You wouldn't have to worry about your body not being the fittest or most beautiful and most sexy.
All you would need to ask yourself is, did I do this better than I did it last time? Have I moved forward in my own definition of success? Am I feeling content? Am I doing my best for my health? Do I have an attractive mind and healthy interactions with other people? In neuro-linguistic programming, broad distinctions are made between predominantly internally referenced people who are generally better at using their own referencing to measure their success and those who are more externally referenced, who look for reassurance and confirmation of their abilities from others. Externally referenced people are more likely to make comparisons with other people as a kind of self-affirmation. But no one lives in a vacuum, and everyone has some kind of referencing system to people outside of themselves. We all have an actual or imagined audience to our lives that gives our actions meaning. One of the first steps in improving self-esteem is to learn where we currently position ourselves on the line of continuum between being internally referenced and externally referenced. Nobody is entirely one type or the other, and different patterns will play out with different people at different times. In the workplace, for example, the quality and nature of the relationships we have with colleagues will be coloured by the degree to which we are externally referenced, and the number and strength of comparisons we make in relation to job roles, personality types, and status. Our behaviour will be determined by these perceptions, and, for example, a conversation with a team member might be very different from a conversation with a line manager. The outcome of the interaction cannot be viewed in isolation from our perceptions of who we are. The boundaries of our role, who our colleague is, the boundaries of their role, and the value of our role compared to our colleague's role. In addition, the perceptions we have and comparisons we make will be based on what we see and hear. However, we see and hear only a small range of other people's behaviour, and we need to take this into account when we examine our perceptions. To pull all of this together, we are making assessments based on a small chunk of information that is internally processed through a system coloured by our own perceptions of self, role, status, and personality type. It is no wonder that many people find success a difficult concept to grasp and find it easier to use other people's measures of success than find their own. The most powerful place on the continuum is in the middle. Having a faith in your own perception and judgment, but still being open and receptive to others' feedback. So, in addition to recognizing...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.